Hello everyone, welcome to the COVID care series presented by Apollo Hospitals. Dr. Srinidhi Chidambaram here, and I do hope that you're all staying well and safe during this COVID-19 pandemic. The COVID-19 pandemic has thrown up more twists and turns than even a thriller or more realistically a horror movie. Last year, we spoke about Wuhan and hydroxychloroquine, and we also thought that young people were not going to get this infection, and even if they did, they were going to be asymptomatic or very, very mild in symptoms. But this year, we are still in the grip of the pandemic. We are going through what they call the second wave, and now we talk about even the third wave, which is impending. And we also hear of younger people who are getting severe diseases, who are getting into ICUs, and we also sadly hear of many cases where there was a fatality. One news report from NDTV says that between May 5th to 11th, Tamil Nadu had over 79 deaths, thrice higher than April deaths, or much more than what it was at the same time last year. In Chandigarh, they say that, according to the Indian Express, that there has been from January to April, the highest number of infections were between the 21 to 49 year olds. But data can be misleading. It can be not comparable. Sometimes you really can't correlate data like that. So it may not be very accurate. We really don't know. That's the truth. And the ICMR does say that it has really not changed since last year. But what has happened because of this is that young people and their families have become very, very stressed and anxious. And as it is, young people are also having a lot of issues with their mental and emotional health. Staying at home, not being able to socialize with their friends, work pressures, family tensions, violence, sometimes even substance abuse, and also the pressure of exams and their careers when they're facing critical exams, and they're all, we don't even know when they're going to happen. And also that oppression of online classes and exams. So what is the reality? What should young people be doing? Are they really at higher risk? Are they getting severe diseases with COVID-19 this time? How do we deal with this? Now, to discuss all this in detail, I'm delighted to welcome Dr. P. Sendur Nambi from Apollo Hospitals, Chennai. Dr. Nambi belongs to the first batch of infectious disease subspecialists to be trained through the fellowship of the National Board in India. He also holds the specialty certificate in infectious diseases awarded by the Royal College of Physicians, UK, and the postdoctoral fellowship in infectious diseases awarded by the Tamil Nadu Dr. MGR Medical University. He is the secretary of the Clinical Infectious Disease Society, India. He is in group practice with 4 ID consultants. The Infectious Disease Consultants, IDC, is the largest ID service in the private sector in India, which offers clinical ID and infection control services at 12 of the Apollo hospitals in the Chennai region. He has several publications, 2 textbook chapters, 41 international conference abstracts in the field of infectious diseases, and believes in compassionate healthcare delivery, and is one of the senior infectious disease consultants of the Apollo Hospitals group. Dr. Nambi, welcome to the COVID care series. I'm so happy that you can join us today, despite you being so busy treating so many patients with COVID-19 in the hospital and making a difference to their lives. Welcome.
Good afternoon, everyone. I thank Dr. Srinidhi and Apollo Group for giving me this opportunity. And it's nice to be in this session for a 30 minutes interaction. And as Dr. Srinidhi has already put out, COVID is a great leveler. I personally feel so. And it exposes the frailties in the minds of our average people, as well as the frailties of the healthcare system is actually exposed by COVID. Gone is a first wave where we all felt that we have come through the first wave, and then the vaccines coming, and then all of us felt that we are not going to have any kind of major impact in terms of what was happening in the Europe, UK, and the US, where they have gone through the second wave. And Unfortunately, India is now right through the second wave. It all started with Maharashtra and then Delhi, the North India, the Western India, and in Tamil Nadu to start with Chennai since the last 4 weeks. And Chennai has actually peaked with the second wave, and the other districts in Tamil Nadu are going through the second wave, probably another couple of weeks that they would peak. The question is, how is the second wave different from the first wave? Does it affect the younger population a lot? If you ask me, probably the number of patients that get hospitalized in the ICU or in the normal inpatient services, the proportion of the younger patients that have been hospitalized in the last 4 to 6 weeks is definitely higher than what it was last year. And gone are the days where an average physician like me would be very confident saying that, guy, you're looking young and then you're just 30, 35, and you don't have any comorbidities, so you would not have any problems. So we do find a small minority of the younger population landing in the ICU with severe pneumonia and complications. And this was not the case last year. And majority of these younger population who lands into the ICU have weight as an important risk factor. They are either morbidly obese or overweight, and who have not been physically active. They do not have a physically active lifestyle. So they have been a sedentary lifestyle mode, younger patients with being overweight and obese. We do find that this is a subset of population which develops severe pneumonia and landing in the ICU. And is this something unique to India? I don't think so. Why I'm saying that is this happened in the UK, Europe, and US also. During the second wave, the proportion of the younger population, when I say young, it's probably someone less than 45 years of age with no comorbidities and no other medical problems, but the proportion of them getting affected was higher in all these Western countries when compared to the first wave, where you had the elderly above 65 years of age getting affected. And why is it different? Probably the first wave, the target population for the virus would have been the elderly population, and that majority of them, or even at least 20 to 30% of them, gets affected. And from the virus standpoint, it has to survive. And probably it tries to look into susceptible population. The susceptible population obviously is the younger lot, which have an active, vibrant social life. And in the last 4 months, all of us have had a vibrant social life, whether it be parties or going out to the malls, cinemas, or even vacations. All those things have happened. And the younger ones were not vaccinated because they were not in that group, or they were not considered the high-risk group for vaccination. So that is another factor. There was active social life coupled with lack of vaccination and relaxation of other norms that would be prudent in the management of public health standpoint of COVID, like using a mask or social distancing. I think all these things were relaxed in India for the last 4 months at least, and that has led to the massive surge of cases, a second wave, and then the susceptible population being the younger age group, less than 45 years, and that is where people are getting infected and affected. But it's not that bad. COVID remains the same. It goes without saying that 80% of patients with COVID will recover on their own. You don't need anything. You don't need to do anything. No medicines, nothing is required. All you need is rest, hydration, paracetamol, and a good nutritious diet. And the immune system is expected to clear the virus on its own between day 3 to day 7 of illness. And if someone cannot clear the virus on their own by between day 4 to day 7, they continue to have symptoms in terms of fever, which goes on beyond day 7, or they have a lot of cough, breathing difficulty. So that is when the problem sets in. So 80%, let it be an older adult or an younger adult, they would definitely clear. And the problem with younger adults is at times they could ignore their symptoms. And when they have symptoms persisting beyond day 7, they may have a slight reluctance to seek medical care. And that is when they have to seek medical care, when their symptoms persist beyond day 7. And at times they do take time, and then they come a little late in the course, and that time you may not be able to do much. So that is one thing that we have to be very clear with COVID. It is a self-limiting viral infection without any doubt, but with the sheer numbers, the huge population being affected, the denominator is really huge, huge, huge. So the numerator, the number of people affected requiring hospital care is still very less. But since the denominator is very high, the numerator also appears big. So would be the media reports, the WhatsApp news, Google news, whatever you get. That is all because of the denominator being high. And this is where it stands. And this is what I feel. And it is, the disease is no way different. Younger population being a little more susceptible because of lack of vaccination and a vibrant social life, they are more likely to get infected right now when compared to the older adults, especially because they have not been vaccinated. That is one major reason. And again, the newer variants, the UK variant in the UK also had a slight affection towards the younger population. And then the Indian variant, which is popularly called as the double mutant virus, that also seems to have a predilection to affect the younger population. All these things have kind of fueled a massive second wave, in which a significant proportion of patients that are affected are younger people, but still the majority do well. And it's not like that someone gets infected, it's the end of the road, something like that. So by day 4, day 5, people get better on their own. And this is my overall thought process. And then probably we could go along with some questions from Dr. Srinidhi and the audience.
So doctor, you were saying that now we do see more younger people, but though they are susceptible to it, is it also that this time you're seeing more severe cases among the younger people, or it's still that same percentage who are actually getting into hospital? Do most of them still have only the usual course of the viral infection?
I think most definitely have the usual course of viral infection without any doubt. But since the denominator, the number of people affected or infected is huge, so you would have, even if 20% seek medical care, and in which 1 or 2% will land in the ICU, but the number of people affected or infected with COVID, when the numbers are huge, even if those 20% requiring hospitalization or 1 or 2% requiring ICU, that numbers is going to be high. And more so with the referral tertiary care practice, it will be skewed up, and so that you would find more people getting affected landing in the hospital ICU. But these are anecdotes. We need countrywide data, and which we do not have right now at this point of time. But the overall perception is we do have younger people who get affected, and very few minority land up in the ICU, and it is not, the disease has not changed. But the number of people affected is more. So that is why you have a very significant minority landing in ICU.
What about, so in this group of people now, how can they actually, who actually gets these? Are there any risk factors among this population? Because we talk about, diabetics being more vulnerable. So in this group of people, what do you see? What are the single or what are the most important factors that make a young person not have mild disease but go on to the severe COVID?
I think it goes without saying, and even there was a recent study which highlighted, which was looking into data across the US, where people with sedentary lifestyle, they're more likely to develop complications related to COVID, irrespective of the age. So a 60-year-old male who walks 30 to 40 minutes per day may be better equipped to handle the infection than a 35-year-old male who spends most of the time sitting in front of the computer or television. So physical activity plays an important role in preventing complications related to COVID. And whatever little information that we have in the last 4 weeks, what we have observed is people who are overweight, people who are morbidly obese among the younger population are much more likely to develop pneumonias requiring hospitalization, both in the ward as well as the ICU. And if they have some other comorbidities, like in terms of diabetes or hypertension, or they have smoking as a habit, smoking cigarettes or tobacco as a habit, they are also likely to develop complications with respect to COVID.
So lifestyle modification is still something which the that group of population can still do. And I think we also hear of a lot of these younger group of people having, you know, without being diagnosed, they still have diabetes or hypertension, which is not diagnosed because they don't go for regular checkups. So I think one message would be that it's important for every group, every age group to take care of their health. So it's not just that only after you turn 50, you have to do you have to control your lifestyle?
Yeah, I think with the current work patterns that we have, where it is predominantly sedentary and we don't move around and it's predominantly sedentary, and if you're not going to have some kind of physical activity on a daily basis, let it be walking, jogging, swimming, or some kind of aerobic exercise, yoga, sedentary lifestyle is a problem for diabetes, hypertension, strokes, plus altered sleep habits. When you work for Western countries with different time zones, your normal sleep cycle gets altered. And all these things have a major impact on the way your body's immune system functions. So sedentary lifestyle plus altered sleep cycle does have a major impact on the immune system. Coupled, and then you add on to it junk food and then have some mild diabetes and hypertension, then you have a deadly mix of all problems happening in a so-called young who is 40 years, but he could have all these risk factors, which is adding on to a period of around 5 to 7 years. That's good enough to cause a major health problem.
Because you spoke about junk food, so now we hear of all kinds of diets and different concoctions and powders and all sorts of things to have to develop so-called immunity. And I think everybody just believes in that and takes it. Or do you have any particular diet or particular anything that works in building up your immunity? Or what should young people eat?
I don't think that
Swiggy, delete Swiggy from their phones, I think will be the first.
I don't think there is one single superfood or one single magic pill that would boost your immune system. If someone claims so, then probably it's definitely not true. Your immune system functioning is a culmination of multiple good habits that you inculcate on a daily basis. And it'll be eating at a proper time. That is very, very important. Not delaying your meal time. Not eating your stomach full. Probably do it 2/3 or even 50%. It's very important. And make sure that you have appropriate proportion of all foods. It will be the carbs, protein, fat, vitamins, the fruits, vegetables. Very important to have the right proportion of food at proper times and not eating full. All these things are very, very important. So would be to have a stress-free life and to have proper sleep, which is compromised. All of us have screen time, even at our bedrooms. We have televisions in our bedroom. And we have our cell phones. People used to are watching YouTubes, even before YouTube channels, before going on to sleep. So all these things eat into the quality of sleep that you have. All these things, if you're going to do this on a daily basis, it does have an impact on the long run. So we may have to rethink the way that we are leading our lives. That will be the food that we eat or the way that we spend our time with gadgets, let it be the television or the smartphones or our laptops, and then have some time for ourselves in terms of physical activity, and then try to keep stress-free whatever possible way, not getting affected by the news, the tension around it. We do strongly believe that COVID is not a bad disease, but COVID phobia, COVIDophobia, the fear about COVID, is actually much worse than COVID, actually. And I keep telling all my patients who get admitted in the hospital, stay strong, be positive. And that is very, very important. Patients who panic, who have a negative frame of mind with COVID, they generally do not do well when they get hospitalized. Even a patient on a ventilator who is feeling positive and strong, and he tells himself that I'm going to get out of it, it really makes an impact, because the mind also plays a very, very important role in recovery, because health is a state of physical, mental and social well-being. The mental part at times never gets focused. It's only about looking into the body, getting tests and scans, and then trying to fix up the problem. Mind plays a huge role in the overall recovery, leave alone COVID, any other medical illness.
Working out during the 4 months before this second wave started, everybody was going to the gym. So what do you think that it's safe for people? I mean, for many of the youngsters, working out means going to the gym. So is it even safe to go back in case they open now? Or should you think of ways to work out only at home?
Any day open space workout is much safer. Gyms are generally cozy, air conditioned. As a result, it could pave the way for spread of airborne infections and droplet infections. So any open space workout, let it be your house terrace, or it could be your beach, park, or those things would always work well. But having said that, I wouldn't say no to working out in gyms. I would say that prefer for open space workout. But if you are comfortable with strength training, for which you'll have to just do it in the routine gym. So all you have to do is make sure that you have some kind of distancing between your other people around, and then use your mask, which is very, very important. And then keep your hands clean. Use soap and water or sanitizer. And make sure that you don't shower, you don't share the toiletries or some other towels that are used in the gym that could be shared between different people. So use your own individual products, use mask, use sanitizer, and if possible, maintain a 3 to 6 feet gap distance between the people at the gym. Could do that consistently, then I would say that it would be fine. And if the vaccine program, when it is going to be opened up for everyone, and if you're going to be vaccinated, then I think that would be a big license for you to do whatever you want to do in terms of social life. So if when the access to vaccine becomes much more easier for the common man, irrespective of the age and comorbidities, then our social life can return back to normal. That is what I think.
I have two questions here. One, you were talking about exercising with a mask. Now, we also read recently in some articles that, you know, it's actually harmful to take a walk outside or do any working out with a mask on. So what is your take on that, doctor?
I work with the mask on every day with an N95 mask. And since morning now, I've done actually 7,000 steps in the hospital, actually. So that is my speedometer count for the day. And then any day I'm having around 10,000 steps with my mask on. So I don't think it's a problem. It's about thinking. There are a lot of false information, propaganda. And
that carbon dioxide doesn't come out and it kind of causes all kinds of
problems. Yeah, I think as long as whatever mask you're comfortable with, let it be a routine surgical mask or a cloth mask, I think you can continue to use it and then have your routine physical activity, whatever is possible outside your home. Within home, you're free to do whatever you want. Outside home, I think we should keep using masks irrespective of whatever the kind of physical activity they're doing, unless you have some major medical problems that compromises the use of masks.
We were talking about vaccines. So now there is a lot of confusion among people that even after taking either one dose or two doses, or after the two dose, even after 14 days, we are turning positive. And there's also some rumor, which I just received something before we started, that, you know, like many people after the second dose, you know, like the immunity is suppressed and hence they get COVID and they all become very sick and they have a higher mortality. I don't know where people get these elaborate stories from, but could you clarify as to what is the connection between, you know, somebody getting vaccinated? Does their immunity actually get lowered for the initial few days after the dose of vaccine?
Definitely not. If you're looking at returning back to normal, the world returning back to normal, you're looking at two public health interventions. One is consistent use of masks. Other one is use of vaccine. So X, Y, Z vaccine, whatever vaccine that we get, all of these have come through some rigorous trials. The safety is taken care. So if you have hesitancy in taking vaccines, then you're putting yourself at risk for picking up the infections and complications. So vaccines is a lifesaver without any doubt. And whatever be the vaccine, no vaccine would work 100%. And that applies to any medicine. So nothing works 100%. So there would be an odd case, one or two, who would develop an infection in spite of taking the vaccine. But what we need to focus is the number of people who get protected by taking the vaccine. The vaccine may not prevent infection, but what vaccine prevents is, COVID vaccine prevents is severe disease, severe pneumonia and deaths. So that way it will save many, many, many lives. All the more when you're through a pandemic, we need two doses of the vaccine. Whatever be the dosing interval the government suggests, with respect to Covaxin, it is clear, 3 to 4 weeks gap, 4 weeks gap. Whereas with Covishield, right now the government says 12 weeks. So you have to finish your second dose. 2 weeks from the second dose, your immunity kicks in. So that is where it is. The immunity to COVID kicks in. So taking a vaccine is not a license to do whatever we want to do. Take the vaccine and then be socially responsible. Use mask. Don't shun mask. It's very, very important to use mask in addition to vaccine. You have to do both the things. Before we have an overall sense of security in terms of the numbers in this country. So the numbers are going to go down drastically, then we can rethink regarding the use of masks. As far as vaccine is concerned, it would help definitely in preventing severe COVID disease and would definitely prevent deaths. Without any doubt, it does not suppress your immunity. It does not make you susceptible to pick up the infection. If at all, it will definitely prevent the individual from getting COVID. It would prevent the individual from dying because of COVID. There is no doubt regarding it. Whatever it let it be, Covishield, Covaxin, or the Sputnik that is going to come, all these vaccines are efficacious and they are generally safe.
There was also this other rumor that was doing the rounds in WhatsApp about girls who they should not take the vaccine during their menstrual period, and this became quite a big rumor, especially in our rural areas. So could you clarify on that as well?
I don't know from how people spin stories like this. Probably they are good enough to write screenplay stories for cinemas and dramas. Okay, and then so would be this: menstruation, don't take vaccine. Vaccine will cause impotence. Vaccine will cause infertility. And all these are all just pure myths. I wouldn't say even myths. These are kind of inappropriate fake news. And none of us really should even think about all these tamashas. We should just go ahead with the use of vaccine without any hesitation, without any inhibition and fear. Vaccine is safe. That's the only way this country is going to come out of this pandemic. Use mask and use vaccine.
The other thing which was also like, you know, a lot of people were very hesitant to take the vaccine also because of what happened to a certain actor who, you know, they said that the heart attack came because of taking the vaccine. And there was really no logical explanation for that, because I think the clots was another thing that was circulating and the clot might have gone into the coronary arteries, which doesn't seem possible to me, but does it seem possible to you?
Unfortunately, the human mind tries to attract negative news. That is the biggest problem. With respect to the actor, what we need to be very clear is there were around 800 and odd people taking the same vaccine along with him at the same hospital, and all of them have done well. So we have to see that. Unfortunately, the mind focuses on one odd event where there was a problem. There were many, 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 many people who had taken along with the actor on that particular date at the same hospital, the same brand of vaccine. They all have done well. So we need to look into the positives and not look at one negative. And I wouldn't say even that is associated with the vaccine. I don't think it is. So it was just a mishap. And I don't think it was related to the vaccine. Let's focus on the positives. Let's focus on the good news. Vaccines will save lives without any doubt. If you're looking at a cleaner or a safer 2022, then in 2021, all of us have to take COVID vaccine. We have no other choice.
Also, when it comes to junk food, the other habit which many youngsters have is on unhealthy diets for losing weight. So there is also this possibility of avoiding certain food groups or going on starvations and extreme fasts or high fat keto type of diets. Now, are these recommended at this point of time? I don't know if they are even recommended at any time, but do they hamper the immunity at this time?
Definitely, I would say that it's not the time to experiment with your diet patterns. Not a good time to do that at all in the midst of a pandemic. So diet, weight loss, all those things can wait. As I had mentioned earlier, eat your proper home-cooked meals. The traditional, if you live in Gujarat, okay, what is there in Gujarat is good enough. If you live in Tamil Nadu, okay, you take your idli dosa. That is good enough for you. Someone living in Chennai. So eat your traditional home-cooked diet at proper time. Don't eat your tummy full. So that's the logic that you have to look into it. Make sure that you take adequate proportions of carbs, protein, and fats. There's no point focusing on only one particular aspect of the diet. Looking into a high protein diet, I would avoid fat. No, I don't think it's appropriate. And I don't think in the middle of a pandemic, we should be experimenting with our diet patterns. I'm not a dietitian, I'm not a nutrition expert, but that's common sense for me to say, this is not the time to experiment with your diet patterns. Follow basic simple rules.
Before we go on to the questions which are coming in from our audience, I would also like to ask you this question about the whole other aspect of people dealing with the pandemic, especially youngsters. I mean, it's just that they have so much to worry about in terms of many things, exams, jobs, job losses, or working from home is very oppressive for especially homemakers, people who also have to manage the home, or the worry that, you know, somebody else will get infected. Plus this lack of company, the lack of, you know, socialization, all these things, you know, people who, we do hear about a lot of depression and a lot of mental health issues, and even a tendency towards turning to substances to get rid of it momentarily and falling into addictions. So can you tell us, you know, what can people do? I mean, how would we have to cope with it? Because we don't have a choice. This is going to be with us for some time.
I think we need to look into the positives. I would say positives is this COVID whole scenario has taught us how to get connected with people, at least through other means, if not the routine means of going and visiting them personally. You have the Zoom meetings, you have the WhatsApp calls, the video calls. It's always nice to be in touch with the peer group. It's very important to release the mental pressure and tension and fall back into your family. It's very important to talk to people in the family, have a meal once all together, sitting together. It's very important. And spend time with yourself. It could be reading book or having some kind of physical activity. If you have a pet, do spend time with the pet. All these things does matter a lot because it's just times of uncertainty. You're looking at job losses. You're looking at uncertain times in terms of money, job, as well as health, loss of colleagues, negative news. So many things are running across the mind. So it's time to keep our mind stress-free. In whatever possible way, it could be physical activity, yoga, could be talking to friends, it could be talking to colleagues, could be to taking help from social groups. And of course, if you think that you cannot handle the stress, it's important to talk to the appropriate medical person. It could be a psychologist or a psychiatrist, or talk to your family physician. Seek help. It's very important to look inward when you go through a crisis, but if you cannot come up with solutions, you will have to seek help from others. It could be a friend, colleague, family member, or a professional like a clinical psychologist or a psychiatrist. But it's very important to understand that we do have a problem. And once that understanding comes, things become much more easier.
So now I will go to the questions. I'll begin with the first one. I'll read it out. It's coming on my phone. I'm 44. I was due to get vaccinated for HPV, meningitis and tetanus, but immunization services have been disrupted. Should I be concerned and should I get the COVID vaccine?
I think, you know, whatever vaccine that you mentioned, HPV, meningitis, tetanus, they all can be taken together, generally not a problem. And with respect to COVID vaccine, the general consensus is give a, at least a couple of weeks gap between the COVID vaccine and other vaccines. So I would probably suggest you to take the COVID vaccine first, because that's the thing that we need to focus on right now as the country is going through the pandemic. Take your COVID vaccine and then finish the second dose, wait for a couple of weeks, and then you can go ahead with the vaccines that you have in your list that has been missed because of the disruption of the services.
I'm pre-diabetic, had COVID 15 days back. I was not given steroid. Right now, my HbA1c is 6.1. I had only mild symptoms, but I'm now very scared of the black fungus and other post-COVID infection. Now, black fungus is the new thing, isn't it? I mean, maybe we should talk about that as well.
Yeah, the problem is, I don't know how we get attracted to such good negative news and propaganda. There is nothing called black fungus. Mucor is not a black fungus. So black fungus is totally different. I do not know how they coined the term black for mucor. Black fungi is totally different.
Yeah, the dark atmosphere, I think.
Mucor is not something new, and it is something not new, or it is not something that is classically associated with COVID. People who have diabetes and under poor control, they are at risk of picking up this infection, which is an environmental fungi. They could have it sitting in their eyes, orbit, which could spread to the brain. And that is something quite common in diabetics who have not been under control. COVID per se, I don't think it increases the risk of mucormycosis. The problem is COVID care in terms of steroids, which is coupled with a poorly controlled diabetes, that puts the patient at risk of picking up the infection. That is where it stands. Coming back to the friend who had asked the question, he has pre-diabetes, so that is good. His HbA1c is fine, pretty good. Second thing is he had a mild COVID and he's not had any steroids. So I don't see him getting black fungus or mucormycosis at all. So he can be happy.
Right. I know there is a risk of getting COVID-19 at the moment, but I feel fine. Can I still play sport?
Yeah, provided you're vaccinated, you have the green signal. If not for the vaccine, then you have the orange signal. So you're at risk of picking up the infection. So if you have taken the vaccine, you have a green signal to play your sport. Not a problem at all.
During this pandemic, is it advised to take supplements and vitamin tablets, even for young people? Now, that's another thing which I think people are now popping all kinds of C, D, zinc, actually, and even turmeric and other things. So is it required, or you don't need all that actually?
Personally, I don't think it is required. I'm seeing around 100, 120 COVID patients every day, and I'm not taking any of those vitamin pills to boost my immunity. I'm just going by taking food at proper time and then sleeping myself and keeping myself stress-free. Having said that, if you have some kind of deficiency, for example, if you are vitamin D deficient, then it makes sense to supplement your vitamin D deficiency. If you are a pure vegetarian, probably you are B12 deficient, and so you might have to take your B12 or folic acid. Routinely taking vitamins as a supplement, I don't think it helps. I don't think it is required. But if it gives you a sense of comfort, the so-called placebo effect in the medical field, you can do it, but that is not something that I would advise.
Can COVID-19 be sexually transmitted?
The mere act of sexual transmission, no, it is not sexually transmitted, but sexual activity involves physical proximity. So if someone has COVID and someone gets close to them and then through physical intimacy, then that could result in transmission of COVID. But it is not sexually transmitted.
What is the guideline for, this is just about people after COVID, when should they take their vaccine?
That guidelines keeps on changing. In general, if you have COVID, you are protected from another episode of COVID for at least 3 months. And if you look into the US recommendations, it's slightly different. They say that you can go ahead with the vaccine at 2 to 3 weeks or even a month. But right now, the government of India has come up with a clear guideline saying that someone has COVID, you could wait till 3 months before you could take the vaccine. Because 3 months is good enough, your vaccine, the natural infection-induced immunity is expected to last long for a minimum period of 3 months. So you could wait for 3 months before you take the vaccine.
Can an epileptic patient of 18 years take the COVID vaccine?
Perfectly, yes. No issues at all. They have to take people of all ages, all comorbidities, irrespective of the medicines that they take, they can take the COVID vaccine without any hesitation and fear.
If the COVID vaccine second dose is not completed on time, what is too late? In that case, if it is too late, can I go ahead with a new vaccine, like some other vaccine, and take both first and second doses?
No one knows what is too late. But as far as Covishield, the UK-based vaccine is concerned, you can wait up to 16 to 18 weeks for taking the second dose. With respect to Covaxin, probably 4 week, or you can extend up to 6 weeks. So if you're not in that time schedule of not taking the second dose as per the schedule, perhaps you may have to reinitiate a fresh set of schedule. But the problem is, whatever we do is through the unique identification number. So you may not get it officially. So perhaps it will take some time before the access to vaccine will get freed up when you have enough supplies and production. So I would actually humbly request the public to take it as per the schedule instead of delaying it for whatever be the reasons, unless you have a medical reason, you had fallen sick and that preempts you from not taking the vaccine at that time. So if you have taken and you missed the second dose, you can reinitiate a new vaccine series. But right now that is not practically possible in our country because of the limited supplies, and it comes through the government, ration through the government. So that is a problem.
So can you then take another vaccine totally, like in case there is an availability and you want to start a new series, then can it be, if you've taken a Covishield, you can next try the, I mean, you can, what if only something else is available at that time?
I think COVID is a dynamic situation, and you could say that the medical field, what was recommended a month before is not recommended now. So that's how it keeps changing. There is data, there is some enough studies going on where people have topped up one vaccine with another kind of vaccine. And there is preliminary data to say that it may not be harmful. And there is preliminary data to say that it could probably do the job. But to come up with a recommendation like that, we need more such data. Probably in a month or 2 months' time, we would have much more clear-cut guidelines on what to do to supplement with another different brand of vaccine. But as of now, it is quite clear that it is not going to give you harm. Whether it will give you benefit, we do not know. Probably in a month's time, we may know that whether it will give us benefit.
So this is the last question. How do couples find balance while working from home?
Probably this should be asked to a mental health professional. Provided they love each other, it becomes easy. And provided they enjoy the comfort of each other, it becomes easy. But if you have been a person that who love working away or staying away from home, then staying at home, it becomes a problem. And that is where sharing responsibilities or reversal of roles, all those things plays a very important role. Probably time for the male to go to the kitchen and give the female a rest and then keep doing things. I think in a way we have to see it, new ways to find love, make love, and as well as express love and spend time together. Let it be watching a movie together or watching, reading a book together, trying to talk to each other, trying to understand each other, which we didn't have time earlier. So probably you could try doing it. Unfortunately, being a medical professional, I don't have that luxury.
The other end of the spectrum, my wife. I think you become more busy. Anyway, Dr. Nambi, thank you so much for this wonderful and illuminating discussion. And if there are any more queries, viewers, as usual, put it on the comments section or on the Facebook Messenger inbox, and we'll get back to you. So thank you, Doctor, for this discussion. And thank you for sparing the time when you've been very busy. Tomorrow, we will be talking about managing non-communicable diseases in our series on the non-communicable diseases and COVID. We'll be talking about cancer and COVID. And the doctor who will be talking to us is Dr. Manish Singhal, senior medical oncologist from Apollo Hospitals, Delhi and Noida. Meanwhile, viewers, please take care, be safe, and I hope you haven't forgotten SMS, which is the social distancing, wear the mask, and sanitize. See you tomorrow. Namaste.
Thank you.